Thank you. That concludes the debate on International Day of Women and Girls in Science. It's now time to move on to the next point of order, Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer, I know you'll be aware that I made a point of order at the beginning of this afternoon's business in relation to correspondence from the Office of the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and I'd like to point out in the spirit of fairness that I am grateful for the very direct and immediate intervention of the Office of the Minister for Parliamentary Business. I have now received a reply to the correspondence I was referencing, and that was actually sent, although not received, on the 25th of January. So I wish to thank the Office of the Minister for Parliamentary Business and also the Office of the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills for handling my query in a timely way, even if there was a technical problem in terms of receiving it. I'd also mention I have removed any reference to my point of order from my social media.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. We will now move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 7853 in the name of Tom Arthur on Scottish rate resolution. Members should note that I will put the question on the motion immediately following the conclusion of the debate, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Cabinet Secretary John Swinney to move the motion.
I move the motion, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I call on Minister Tom Arthur to speak to the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to draw the Parliament's attention to the procedural connection between this debate and Rule 9.16.7 of the Standing Orders, which states that a Scottish rate resolution must be agreed before Stage 3 of the Budget Bill is able to proceed. Presiding Officer, this rate resolution debate is set against a backdrop of one of the most challenging periods for the economy and public finances that we have seen since devolution almost a quarter of a century ago. Over the course of the last year, we have seen Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine, a cost of living crisis, spiralling inflation, and the continuing economic impact from Brexit, all while recovering from a global pandemic. We have been forced to navigate all of this essentially with our hands tied, given the limited fiscal powers at our disposal. Not only are we unable to borrow to support businesses and households in these challenging times, we also have no legislative powers over key policy areas that would support the wider economy, such as the energy market and immigration. Therefore, Presiding Officer, in the 2023-24 budget, we have taken the difficult but necessary decisions to allow us to protect our vital public services, upon which so many households, communities and indeed the Scottish economy relies on. Certainly.
Willie Rennie.
We will cautiously support the resolution today, but since it's an emergency, we understand the need to protect the public finances. But if the public finances improve, the economy improves, is it the government's intention to restore the lower levels of taxation before this resolution?
Minister.
I want to thank Mr. Rennie for his support for the resolution, for his constructive engagement, and indeed for his enthusiasm when he wants to start talking about the 24-25 budget at this stage. As I'm sure he appreciates, we will set out decisions on tax policy at each budget in turn, which will take into account a number of factors, including the prevailing economic conditions. It is, however, at this point vital, and now more than ever, that we are guided by the principles of our framework for tax, which we published in December 2021. And one of these principles is engagement. And that is why, ahead of the Scottish Budget, the Deputy First Minister and I listened to a range of stakeholders, and we thank all those involved for their input. Presiding Officer, we heard a consistent message from our engagement that we need to use the tax powers to support and invest in our public services, reaffirm our commitment to reaching net zero emissions, tackle child poverty and support the economy. Our income tax policy for 2023-24 responds to this, seeking to strike a balance between ensuring there is enough money for public spending and acknowledging the challenging economic conditions facing households and businesses, and support Scotland being a great place to live, work, study and do business. Our proposed income tax policy for 2023-24 is for there to be no changes to the starter, basic or intermediate rates and bands to protect those on lower incomes. We also propose no change to the current higher rate rate threshold of £43,662 and lowering of the top rate threshold from £150,000 to £125,140. Finally, we propose raising the higher and top rates of tax by 1 pence, bringing them to 42 pence and 47 pence, respectively. We have estimated that the income tax policies which I am asking members to vote for today will raise an additional £519 million for the Scottish Budget in 2023-24. These policy changes, grounded by our principles of taxation, will enhance the progressive approach to tax that we have taken to date. The majority of additional revenue raised from these changes will come from those individuals and households in the top two income deciles. Our approach will mean we can continue supporting our leading social contract with the people of Scotland, while also ensuring the majority of taxpayers still pay less in income tax than if they lived elsewhere in the UK. And crucially, as set out by the Deputy First Minister in his budget statement in December, the changes announced for 2023-24 mean we will be in a position to exceed the health resource Barnett consequentials received from the UK Government with substantial additional investment for our National Health Service. Our NHS is a precious public asset, and by choosing to raise more revenue from tax to invest in vital frontline services, we are making an investment that will benefit all of us. Presiding Officer, I would like to close by reminding members that not only have we had to make these income tax policy choices in the difficult economic climate that we face, but within what has been frankly a political chaos set by the UK Government in the past year. 2022 saw a total of four UK chancellors in the space of 4 months. We saw constant U-turns on tax policy from UK government ministers, and we should not forget the ill-judged tax cuts from their short-lived mini-budget in September and the impact on financial markets that many in Scotland are still facing as a consequence. This chaos presented significant challenges for developing our transparent income tax policy in Scotland. The UK Government's financial plans look increasingly bleak, and it is no doubt that this will present significant fiscal challenges for us here in Scotland. The OBR estimates that the UK has entered a recession that will last for over a year. Well, just last week, the IMF suggested that Britain will be the only G7 economy forecast to shrink in 2023. Presiding Officer, this Government is clear on what its priorities are. We are choosing to invest in the economy, to invest in our leading social contract, and to invest in the people of Scotland. And that is why I ask members today to vote to ratify the proposed changes to Scottish income tax set out in the Budget 2023-24.
Thank you. I now call on Liz Smith.
Thank you. The Minister is quite correct that there is a convention in this Parliament. I think it's Rule 9.16.17 of Standing Orders that a rates resolution absolutely must be passed before stage three of a budget process so that that can happen. And while it's, I think, very clear that there are strongly different views about tax policy, in fact, I think Mr Rennie has just opened up another difference of tax opinion. I'll be interested to see what he's saying this time next year about Liberal Party policy. But we do have that difference of opinion. But of course, there is the restraining order upon us that if we were to vote against a resolution, it does actually mean that we would be prevented, or the Scottish Government would be prevented from collecting any tax whatsoever. And of course, I think from that angle, that particularly just now, that would send out an irresponsible message because it means, obviously, a time of great economic difficulty and of people who are under the cosh with raising sufficient revenue. That is a difficult thing, and I think it would be irresponsible to vote against it. So I can put on record that we will not be opposing the rates resolution, but I do want to put on record that we have very considerable differences of opinion with the Scottish Government about tax. Now, Presiding Officer, in recent weeks this Parliament has witnessed several debates, whether in the Chamber or in the Committee, about the economic priorities that will be required as we continue our efforts to tackle the very difficult economic circumstances that the Minister has referred to. The fallout from the war in Ukraine, the many problems of supply chains and energy costs, labour markets and having to adapt to a post-COVID and post-Brexit landscape, and of course the significant changes that happened with UK government policy in fiscal terms. And despite our differences and the committee's report, I think we have agreed actually on some main objectives in this, especially in relation to addressing the skills gap and retraining in terms of encouraging different policies that will promote economic growth, and also to ensure that we can do something about the labour market inflexibilities. And I'm grateful to both the Cabinet Secretary and to the Minister for engagement on that basis, because there is a huge issue about people leaving the labour market post-COVID, either because of long COVID issues or because that they've decided for one reason or another that they wish to come out of the labour market. We had an exchange at stage two, and I do share the Cabinet Secretary's concern about that. And of course, we are especially keen in Scotland to ensure that it remains a very attractive place in which to work and to live and to invest. And I think it's very important that is something that is right at the centre of our deliberations. Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for giving way, and I'm interested in the line of argument that she's developing, because essentially she goes into territory where the tax system can be utilised to try to create incentives, but as she will appreciate, that's not within our range of responsibilities. And without me trying to make a big constitutional song and dance about it, does she accept that these are legitimate areas where additional flexibility might be of use in trying to address the very specific and real issue that she raises in relation to participation in the labour market?
Liz Smith.
Yes, I do, Cabinet Secretary. I think that tax incentives are absolutely critical, and where we've had obviously some very considerable differences of opinion about the behavioural aspects of different tax policies, and that's something that I'm sure we'll rehearse again as time goes on. But you're quite right, it is important that incentives are very much part of the tax decision. Taxes, the decisions that you make about them are very much about the choices that you have chosen. You've taken different decisions on tax policy from what we would like to see, and would be particularly concerned and looking at what the Fiscal Commission's recommendations are about where we have to focus in light of the statistics that they have produced for the next few years, because there are some really worrying trends coming down the track for that. So I think that there are a lot of issues that we have to think about. We also have to think about the fiscal framework, which is due to be renegotiated. Cabinet Secretary signed that fiscal framework back in 2016, and I think there's a lot of interesting debate to be had about that and ensuring that the fiscal situation for this Parliament is as effective in line with, we'll have different constitutional perspectives, but in line with what the UK is saying too. So I think there's general agreement that there are issues about quite a lot of aspects of what we need to focus on. Obviously, the political debate is going to continue about how we address these things. But I can put on record again that we will not oppose the rates resolution when it comes to decision time.
Thank you. I now call on Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, President. So I'd like to begin by saying I thought it was deeply unfair of the Cabinet Secretary to make the Minister for Finance chuckle as he got to his feet. Tax is a very serious business, and I thought the Cabinet Secretary was a serious man, but I'll just put that on record.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very happy to confirm that I was not in any way deliberately trying to make the Minister chuckle. I was just somewhat discomforted by the fact that I was having to move the resolution and thought a speech was due to follow, which thankfully the Minister came to my rescue.
Daniel
Johnson. Well, in fairness, I think that's a matter for the Minister of Finance, and we'll hear from him later. But look, I think in a sense, I'm pleased to see these proposals come forward. Ultimately, I think what we're seeing is the powers granted by the 2016 Scotland Act being used. We have some £19 billion being raised directly by those powers exercised by the Scottish Government. That represents some 35% of all revenues available, and in fact 44% of revenue funding. And I think that is important, that we see that bit of the budget, that part that's under its control, being used and exercised. And I think the other day the Cabinet Secretary described this as being in the foothills of variation of tax policies. And I'm someone that is pleased to see that. This is what devolution is about. I'd also note that these are progressive measures. Tax is a part of the social compact, where those who benefit from public services are asked to contribute. And indeed, those who have the ability to pay more do so. So Scottish Labour will be supporting the rate resolution this evening. And indeed, I would note that the use of the top rate of tax was something that we called for back in 2019. But this brings me to the next point. And reflecting, but not necessarily completely mirroring the comments from both Willie Rennie and Liz Smith, we do need to look at the effectiveness of these powers. The behavioural impacts need to be studied. I suspect they may be overstated, but I think we need to examine in detail whether or not the behavioural impacts do take away from the mechanical increases that would have been predicted. Likewise, I think we need to look at the effects of fiscal drag. That's something that I think is of concern to the Finance Committee. And in particular, also the interactions between the Scottish bans and rates and other taxations, particularly national insurance, which I think we have some anomalies now in our tax regime, and I think we need to look at how we examine those. And finally, I think we do need to look at the fact that the inflection point where you start paying more tax in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK is some £28,000. Now, that will take in people who are in promoted posts in the teaching profession, nurses. And I think we need to examine all of these issues in the round, be evidence-led to ensure that we do have a progressive taxation, but it also is effective. So, and I say that just, you know, I think that it's important that we assess that. Ultimately, I believe that while this is progressive, tax and raising taxes isn't a benefit in and of itself. And while I absolutely support the right of the Scottish Government to have a different taxation policy from the UK Government, I think that's really important. If we are going to have a sustained higher level of taxation, we need to continue to test and challenge to ensure that we get commensurate benefit. And I would seek to do that. And finally, the clear point of fact with the fiscal framework is that it operates on the basis of average tax receipts per person in Scotland and their growth being higher than the rest of the UK. If that is sustained, then we have greater tax receipts, more money to spend in Scotland. And therefore, I would say to the Scottish Government, we need an increased focus on growing jobs and wages, because that will ultimately be good for the Exchequer in Scotland, but it's also good for Scottish people. So we will be supporting the rate resolution. And indeed, these topics are ones that I would seek to explore in months and years to come as we explore tax devolution and tax variation in Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by briefly picking up on an issue which has dogged our debates on taxation in recent years. It's not come up this afternoon, but it did during last week's debate on the budget, and I didn't have time to pick up on it then. And it was whether or not Scotland is better off as a result of income tax devolution. And we're all at the stage now where we recognise that as a result of the specific arrangements in the fiscal framework, it's true to say that in recent years, Scotland ended up with less revenue to spend on public services than if income tax had not been devolved. That is completely separate to the question of whether or not we have benefited, our public finances have benefited as a result of the changes that we have made to income tax through that devolution. And it's absolutely true to say, and I'll come on to this later on, that our public services have substantially benefited from the progressive changes that we've made. And I think it would benefit the debates that we have on tax in this Parliament to recognise the significant difference between those two, particularly when I believe there is a cross-party consensus on the need to reform the fiscal framework. As I said last week, despite the immense challenges, this is the greenest budget in the history of the Scottish Parliament, and that is funded in part by the most progressive tax system in the UK, a point confirmed just earlier today by the Institute for Fiscal Studies. By raising the higher rate of income tax and the additional dwelling supplement, the highest earners and those buying holiday homes and extra properties will pay a bit more to fund the public services which are so desperately needed during this cost of living crisis. Scotland has extremely limited devolved taxation and revenue-raising powers. We certainly need more powers over tax, borrowing and a more functional reserve, but we have an obligation to make the best use of the powers that we've got. In 2018, the Scottish Greens worked with the government to deliver progressive changes to income tax. We lowered the tax paid by the lowest paid workers and increased it for those on higher incomes. Our public services are better off to the tune of £1 billion as a result of the progressive changes we've made in the last couple of years. But given the monumental pressure the budget is now under and the need for high-quality public services during this economic crisis, we do need to go further. And I'm proud of the agreement that we reached on these further changes, which will raise over £500 million more for our public services. We might be in a cost of living crisis, one pushing many households to crisis point, but there are plenty of high-income and wealthy people in this country who can afford to pay a bit more. Those on the highest incomes can afford an extra penny on the tax rate paid on the top slice of their salary. And those in the position where they can buy a second home or a holiday home can absolutely afford to pay a bit more on that purchase. It's incumbent on those who are opposed to these progressive changes to both explain why they think the most privileged people in our society shouldn't be paying a bit more right now, and to explain what they would cut from the budget if they were to prevent those changes. I welcome in particular the contribution that Liz Smith made to this debate, recognising the challenges that would be posed by voting down the rates resolution and the position that the Conservatives have come to. And I absolutely agree with the points that Ms Smith made about labour market participation. I would commend to the Chamber the study by Sheffield Hallam University on this that found there's a substantial number of people in Scotland, perhaps in the tens of thousands, who would like to work but are currently on incapacity benefits because they're unable to find the kind of employment that meets their needs as a disabled person. These are not people who are trying to avoid being in work. These are people that we've not put the right employment support in place for them to join the labour market and for them to contribute to our public finances through their tax revenue. In the period leading up to the publication of this budget, both the SDUC and Unison produced their own papers on tax reform. Both sets of those papers advanced the principle that those who have the most should contribute the most. And while most of their specific proposals were for long-term legislative change rather than for this budget, I believe they deserve a large share of the credit for these immediate-term progressive changes to income tax and the additional dwelling supplement that we're voting on today. The long-term changes that they've proposed, though, can't be lost as we move rapidly from one annual budget cycle to the next. Despite the challenges, this budget delivers for people and planet. It includes a record £2.2 billion to tackle the climate emergency. It delivers more affordable public transport. It provides essential support to children and families. And it does so by having the wealthiest in our society pay a bit more. That is something worth voting for.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Scottish Liberal Democrats have considered the vote on the rate resolution separately to that which will come on the budget after recess. In this debate a year ago, few would have predicted double-figure inflation or that Vladimir Putin would invade the sovereign territory of Ukraine. And nobody could have foreseen the extent to which the incompetence of the Conservatives would trash the economy and the public finances. Public services have had to brace themselves against these winds. It has been a protection operation, in the words of Sir Anton Muscatelli, as he told the Scottish Parliament's Finance Committee. But it is essential to grow the economy because Scotland has underperformed relative to the UK since tax powers were first devolved. The Scottish Fiscal Commission believes that ministers may already be losing out almost £700 million of income tax revenue. And worse still, it's expecting Scotland's economy to grow more slowly over the next 50 years. Today, IFS analysis shows that average net household income will be reduced by £110 next year through the tax and benefit changes. The bottom third of households with children will gain on average around £1,200 a year due to the child payment. But poorer houses without children will, in the IFS words, see virtually no change in their incomes. They have rent to pay, rising food and energy bills, which is why we need to see progressive changes to the budget, such as a new national emergency insulation programme. Presiding Officer, we have supported modest tax rises previously to deliver essential investment and will do so today as we are in an emergency. However, for those on the higher end, the cumulative effect of tax changes matters. Next year, someone earning £50,000 will pay over £1,500 more in Scotland than if they lived elsewhere in the UK. Somebody earning £150,000 will pay almost £4,000 more. These are talented people and that we are already short of, the consultants we desperately need in our NHS, cyber analysts, tech innovators, the best engineers. Now, I don't believe that one-off defined and limited tax rises have a significant impact on behaviour, but they do need to be confident about the future intentions of governments. And I think that's where the intervention of my friend and colleague Willie Rennie came from. If they think that they have lost control of the tax rises, the confidence drops and that affects that behaviour. When these individuals come to weigh up where they want to live and work, it could cost us dearly if the Scottish Government has lost that confidence. They are mobile and there are opportunities elsewhere in the United Kingdom. It is an imperfect science, but I am not convinced that the government understands what they are thinking and their behaviour really matters to that tax take. Where is that evidence? And I think higher taxpayers are worried about the long-term intentions of the SNP government. The presence of the Greens does not reassure them. It adds to the uncertainty about the direction of taxation and the perception that the government may go much further and take tax to extraordinary levels. They don't know what is going to happen next. The social contract is also being stretched by government incompetence. The ferries have become a symbol of that. Then the ScotWind, the best chance for generations to bring serious money into the public purse. But Scotland's prized seabed was sold on the cheap. And I fear that the National Care Service will be the next shambles. I worry we are coming to a tipping point, that some will say enough is enough. So I'm telling the Scottish Government today that you can't guarantee our support if you bring forward further tax increases. Scottish Liberal Democrats fought for tax powers for this Parliament. And when we proposed a moderate penny for education in 2016, it was for a defined purpose and period. It was designed to make education the best again, driving the economy and growth. Now there is a crisis in every corner of our NHS and social care. It is unprecedented. So we can see the logic in a penny, a further penny, that is, for health at this moment in time. Putting aside the refusal of the SNP government to acknowledge their role in
if you could please conclude, Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
We can see the necessity in fixing. I would like an answer to from the Cabinet Secretary in their closing remarks. Will those tax increases remain if that health crisis abates? I don't think that answer was given to Willie Rennie. So if he can find it in himself to give it to us in his closing remarks, I'd be very grateful. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Tom Arthur to wind up. Up to 4 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am conscious that it is me that stands between members and recess, so I will keep my remarks as brief as possible. Can I just begin by thanking folk from across the Chamber for their contributions this afternoon, and also welcome that no member is intending to vote against the SRR, and welcome that pragmatic approach. Just touching on...
Minister, if you could just give me one moment. I would be grateful if members who are just coming into the chamber could do so quietly and if conversations could cease. Minister.
Let me say, just to build on the response that I gave to Willie Rennie's intervention and direct response to Alex Cole-Hamilton's question, he asks about what our future policy will be on tax at different budgets. I would just ask, I think the member, as other members have eloquently summarised, the very changed landscape we find ourselves in over the past year. I'm conscious that it was only 3 years ago that we became familiar with the term COVID, and we still have 3 years to run until the next election. So I think members would agree that it is a sensible, prudent and practical approach to recognise that decisions around taxation are best taken at the budget in line with a range of circumstances. I'll give way to Mr Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
I completely understand that point. The world is unpredictable. But I hope he understands our point about the balance, the need to have proper evidence to make sure that in future years that we don't create behavioural change with a cumulative effect on tax, and that we do consider the possibility of reversing tax changes we brought in an emergency. I hope he understands that.
Minister.
I do entirely, and I think that speaks to the importance of the independent and robust assessment and forecast provided by the Fiscal Commission, and indeed also the Government's own process of engagement, and indeed adhering to the principles and objectives that are set out within our framework for tax. What I would want to recognise, Presiding Officer, is that the devolution of income tax affords us the opportunity to take a different approach in Scotland, and indeed devolution affords us the opportunity to take a range of different approaches across a range of areas. And our powers over income tax and taxation more widely are central to enabling us to do that, to fulfil that commitment to delivering the best social contract that we possibly can. And I would note the recent findings from the IFS report, which recognise that the Scottish Government's changes to the income tax and benefit systems over the past 6 years will make the Scottish system considerably more progressive than that of the rest of Great Britain. And I would also recognise that from the same report, findings that since 2017, the poorest 10% of households will see their incomes increase by £580, 4.6% per year, compared to the rest of the UK, England and Wales, while the richest 10% will see their incomes fall. And amongst the poorest 30%, Scottish reforms to the income tax and benefit system are set to raise the income of households with children by around £2,000 per year on average. That is made possible because we have these powers over income tax. And it also speaks to the point that powers are for a purpose and they can affect real change. And in this change, material change in the circumstance that individuals on low incomes find themselves in. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious that we are out of time now, but I just want to once again thank members from across the chamber for their constructive input and indeed to thank them for their support, or at least lack of opposition, to the Scottish Rates Resolution.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the Scottish Rates Resolution. We'll now move on to the motion, and Rule 11.3.1 requires that the question on the Scottish Rate Resolution be put immediately after the debate. And the question, therefore, is that Motion 7853, in the name of Tom Arthur, on Scottish Rate Resolution be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.